This might look like a bunch of pipes, but this video isn't about plumbing. It's about this weird graph that shows all of the energy made and used in the United States in 2022. I know, it looks complicated and a little boring, but bear with me because it made me realize that there's something fundamentally wrong with how we talk about energy. See, this graph has something in common with this one from Germany, and China, and India, and Australia, and basically every country on Earth. It's this part right here, and it could single-handedly reshape how we think about switching away from fossil fuels to cleaner forms of energy, like sun and wind. Because it turns out, we don't need to replace all of the fossil fuels we're burning. We actually only need to replace a third of them. Here's why. This type of graph is called a Sankey flow chart. It's a bird's eye view of how energy flows into and through modern society. Let's break down what's actually going on. The graphs measure the amount of energy at four different stages in the energy chain. They're called primary, secondary, final, and useful. Primary energy is the original stuff that's used to produce power, whether it's a piece of coal or the wind that turns a turbine. That primary energy is converted into secondary energy, which basically makes it transportable. That's the electricity that goes into the grid, or the petrol that gets sent to your local petrol station. When that electricity or petrol gets to you, it's called final energy. This type is going to be really important later on. And then, when you actually use it, it's called useful energy. Now, if we look at where the vast majority of our primary energy comes from, things look really bad. Despite decades of activism and investment in renewables, fossil fuels still supply 80% of the world's energy. That's the figure that people who are skeptical about renewables bring up a lot. They use it to say we're stuck with fossil fuels because it's impossible to replace them in time.
Fossil fuels right now are 80% of the world's energy. All these plans involve using all solar and wind in the near future, and I think there's no evidence that that's doable.
Solar and wind can be a nice add-on. It can help somewhat, but it's not going to be the main supplier.
We are, and for a long time, we shall remain a fossil fuel civilization, period.
But the 80% number is really only half the story. This graph also shows something that the skeptics aren't talking about very much, and that's all these grey lines. See, every stage of this process is inefficient, and some portion of the energy is wasted. It ends up in this huge section here, the fifth type of energy, which is called rejected energy. And all these flowcharts from around the world show pretty much the same thing. The majority, two-thirds, of the energy we produce is wasted.
People are always shocked by the amount of, you know, what we refer to as rejected energy or wasted energy.
That's Kimberly Mayfield, a research scientist who leads the team at Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory that makes these charts. Scientists here have been drawing them since the middle of the 20th century.
Let me go find my oldest, dustiest one in here. There's some yellowing paper. They're even in the page protectors here. Let's see, we got 1970 US energy flow. Flowchart at the bottom. You kind of see it.
She says that despite the data going back over six decades, most people just aren't aware of how inefficient our current systems are.
It's not something that you can see. It's not like there's a garbage bin where rejected energy goes into. I think that if there was a garbage bin where everybody saw wasted electrons piling up, they might really, you know, take notice and see the rejected energy and see the impact that efficiencies have, right?
So what happens when we do start to take notice of all this inefficiency? Is any of this actually fixable?
From an engineering point of view, it's good fun.
That's Emma Mooney. She's an energy efficiency analyst at the International Energy Agency, one of the biggest trackers of how our modern energy systems work.
It's like being a detective sometimes, like how can I make this better? You know, what can I do to improve the system?
Let's go back to the graph. It's pretty easy to see one of the biggest culprits is generating electricity. When coal or natural gas is burnt to move a steam turbine, the majority of that heat is lost to the environment.
These are huge plants. These plants cost a lot, the equipment costs a lot, and they can be in use for maybe 20 or 30 years. So they might start off as being efficient, but by the time they get towards the end of their life, they're getting more and more inefficient.
And while most power plant operators claim to run 24/7, plants do need to go offline, whether for planned maintenance or due to unexpected outages. And that creates a lot of wasted energy.
It takes time for the systems to warm up, and you get a lot of heat loss just in the system getting warmed up. So you can imagine you'll have a huge burner, for example, and a huge boiler. It's full of metal that needs to heat up itself before it can start getting to the temperatures that it needs to generate the electricity. So there are lots of losses.
And that problem gets even worse when we push the electricity grid to its limits. That's called peak demand, and when we reach or exceed it, utility companies start to turn on older, less efficient plants to keep up with the demand.
Even if it's only a tiny, tiny amount over what we normally use, we have to bring online some of the older plants. And when we bring online the older plants, they're inefficient and they're not generating at their full capacity.
But we're not just losing energy on this side of the graph. A lot of it, the majority in fact, gets lost when we go from final energy to useful energy. And that's because of how inefficient fossil fuel-based appliances and engines are. Think of putting your hand over a gas stovetop. Even if you're heating something up, most of the energy from burning the gas is lost as ambient heat in your kitchen. Only around 40% of that heat is actually being used to cook things. That's similar to what happens in a car engine. For every litre of petrol that goes into your tank, only about 20 to 30% is actually used to move your car. The rest is just wasted, whether as thermal losses from the engine or to power other parts of the car's system. And when you add up all the ways in which energy gets lost, from heating your home to big industrial processes to moving all of our stuff around with trucks, we get to this crazy number at the end. Around two-thirds of the energy that goes in serves absolutely no purpose for us. So that sounds pretty bad. But in reality, this is really good news. That's because renewable energy generators like solar panels, wind turbines, and hydropower plants don't need to burn anything to produce electricity.
It's not that they're more efficient, it's just that we use them straight away. So we use fossil fuels to generate heat that drives the turbine that generates electricity. When we do a wind turbine, we're skipping those first two processes and going straight to the turbine, which generates the electricity.
Even when you factor in the losses that come from the grid, battery storage, or hydroelectric turbines, the vast majority of the energy generated from these sources ends up becoming electricity that you can use. And something else really important would happen if we got rid of fossil fuels. All of the machines we rely on today that burn gas or petrol to work would now have to use electricity instead. And that makes them way more efficient too. Let's take that same gas stovetop from before. If you swap it out with an induction stovetop, which wastes very little energy as heat, you end up using around a third of the primary energy that a gas stovetop uses. How about switching to an EV? Well, you're now using around 90% of the energy that goes in to move your car. And some electric options, like heat pumps, are able to do 3 or 4 times as much work for the same amount of primary energy used as their fossil fuel-based alternatives.
If we had to replace all our current energy use with renewables, I really would be very pessimistic. If we can replace half our current energy use with energy efficiency, and then the other half with renewables, then it looks a whole lot easier.
That's Nick Eyre, an energy and climate policy researcher at Oxford. He wrote a paper in 2021 that worked out how much energy we would be using in a fully electrified society.
People had done it for individual bits of the transition, but no one had been stupid enough to try to plough through world energy statistics and do the whole lot.
What he found was that we would be saving a lot of energy. In fact, we'd need about 40% less final energy than we currently do. And remember, that's this side of the graph, not that side.
The switch to renewables involves a switch to electricity, which helps energy efficiency. So you've got this synergy between efficiency and renewables. So it's not just half doing one, half doing the other. When you look at the whole system, the two halves sort of help each other.
It's easy to feel like we're moving way too slow when it comes to transitioning away from fossil fuels. But if we shift our thinking away from the amount of stuff we need to put in to the amount of stuff we need to get out, the picture looks a whole lot less bleak. Switching to renewables gives us a lot more bang for our buck, and it means we have to electrify most of the things we do, which makes those things less energy intensive in the first place. And for a lot of us, there's not much we can do individually to change where we get our primary energy. But focusing more on how to efficiently get what we need is something that everyone can do. So the next time you hear climate skeptics say it's simply too difficult to switch to renewables, and that we simply have to depend on fossil fuels for the foreseeable future, think back to this graph. So what do you think? Is getting rid of fossil fuels easier than it seems? Let us know in the comments below and subscribe to our channel. We release new videos for you every Friday.